Thanks, Margarita, and thanks everyone for coming. Hopefully this will be insightful. How many of you here consider yourself a peak performer? In some capacity, right? Not necessarily athletics, but in some way, shape, or form. How many wish you were a peak performer in some capacity? Okay, so part of my journey, I was curious about why people do what they do and how we can do it better. I was fortunate, now that I know about behavior design, to grow up in a small community where basketball is highly emphasized. The reason why that was important now that I realized is because everything was designed for me to be successful at basketball, and then also partly at academics. My high school basketball coach also happened to be the AP bio and chemistry teacher, so I built a great relationship with my high school basketball coach because I was a star basketball player. It didn't hurt that I was a 6'9", 14-year-old in a community that loved basketball more than anything else. And so I built this relationship where I had a perfect environment to be successful, both in basketball and in academics. And that only continued on when I was in college. It also helped that said basketball coach was a big fan of performance psychology and self-help, right? So I got into this very early on. I remember telling somebody once I got to Stanford that I read the book Punished by Rewards by Alfie Cohn as a 13-year-old. And they proceeded to tell me that that was their graduate school research in education. So I was exposed to a lot of these ideas from a young age without really knowing how important they were and was applying them. Fast forward until the end of my senior year when I was reading a book by Ramit Sethi, who's one of BJ's former lab members as well, and I got to read a little bit more about behavior design. So applying the psychology of human behavior to getting desired outcomes. So not just accidentally having things happen, but having them happen on purpose, choosing to design for a defined behavior. At that moment, everything kind of clicked for me as to why I was so successful. Again, I was able to look back and say I was in a community of 3,000 people. Not only was I not the tallest person, there's many people my height. Okay, so I was in a community of other people that could challenge me and push me as a basketball player. Like I mentioned, my basketball coach was also one of the top academic teachers in the school in a small community. And he also loved performance psychology and how to help me get better. So I was surrounded by this environment that then continued on when I came to Stanford. When you come around Stanford, you're surrounded by peak performers, both athletically and academically. In my years at Stanford, I was surrounded by number one draft picks, Andrew Luck, Chinea Gwumike, who was the number one pick in the WNBA, Neka Gwumike, who was the number one pick in the NBA, Mark Appel, who's the number one pick in the MLB. So lots of elite athletes. I was also surrounded by people that were changing the world academically. So my inspirations when I was in high school was I was going to be high school teacher, high school coach, because that's what inspired me as a high schooler. But by the time I got to Stanford, I realized there was much larger possibilities. Just by being around people at Stanford and in this environment, you're surrounded by peak performers. So I was fascinated by that, and that caused me to think more about how do we design for peak performance. And part of it is defining what that is for you. So all of us, in my mind, are peak performers, whether it's in your career, in whatever you choose to do. It might be athletics, it might be academics if you're a student, it might be your profession. And we can design to be successful at that. So for me personally, that became play present. So play present also applies a lot of performance psychology. So not just behavioral psychology, performance psychology, how we can do things better. Our brain evolved to be able to survive. So our psychology is very much fight or flight versus survive and thrive. So my goal was to take performance psychology, these ideas that most of the time were not in life or death situations. For example, speaking in front of a group of people. How many people, the thought of speaking in front of a group of people makes you kind of a little bit nervous? You might start sweating, palm sweating, and don't look forward to that at all. Anybody? Anybody? Okay? But you're not really in danger. I could come up here and just blow this completely, be absolutely terrible, and the worst that would happen is I go home and never get invited back. Right? You guys will probably forget about me, and nothing will ever come from it. You might see me 2 years later, and not even besides the fact that I'm 6'9". Not remember me at all, okay? If I was normal height and stature, you could probably pass me on the street and nothing would be different, right? But that psychology was very, very important for our survival through much of the history of humankind, right? If I wasn't able to run away from a lion, I would die. So we had fear built in. If we heard a twig snap out in the woods, that was a very logical response for our survival. However, we shouldn't have that response when we're giving a presentation. We shouldn't have that response when we are performing for a group of people or when we're at work. When our boss walks through the hallway, we shouldn't have this fearful response. So the performance psychology side is, how do we then reframe and shift that so that we can perform? So moving from surviving to what I like to call thriving, so changing our psychology. So I sought out to combine the behavior design piece and the performance piece. So how do we use behavior design to re-ingrain and help people develop habits and behaviors to thrive and perform at a high level? So that led me to a couple different things. So I'm going to talk a little bit about our process of how we create systems for peak performance. So the first one is starts with awareness. Okay, so mindfulness and meditation is all about building an awareness. Without knowing what we are doing, or how, we don't know how to do it better. So starting with awareness, how do you build in awareness? Okay, once you're aware, it takes repetition. To be great at anything, you need to have reps. Okay, so if I wanted to be a great basketball player, I need to get in the gym and get a lot of repetitions. Finally, experience. There will come a time where you will have an experience that something works, right? So, for example, if I'm working on a move in the gym, all of a sudden I'll get into a sports performance situation and the move will work. Okay, so I'm aware that I need to do something. Okay, then I create repetitions, I rep it out, and then finally I'll have an experience. Well, we like to say awareness activates your ability. Unless you're aware of something, you can't change it. Once you're aware of something, you can change it, and you can create situations, and this to me is where behavior design comes in. Because we need to design our environment to give us the repetitions necessary so that we can have these experiences. And it's my belief that once you have those experiences, it's game over, because you can't turn back. So once I had the experience of what behavior design was, it all clicked for me. I knew that there was no going back. I started designing everything in my life, the food I ate, how I exercised, and I was constantly iterating, okay? So if you think about it, it's A-R-E. Awareness activates your ability. Repetition leads to attention, and experience evolves your understanding of how things work. So I want to get into now the behavioral piece. How many of you are familiar with BJ Fogg's behavior model? Right? A lot of people. Well, we'll just go over it really quickly. Okay. So the Fogg behavior model is a behavior occurs when you have motivation, ability, and trigger occurring at the same time. Okay. And if you picture it on a graph, and we have motivation on the y-axis and ability on the x-axis, motivation can range from high to low, and ability can range from hard to do to easy to do. And then you have an action line that looks something like this. So what the action line means is that for any specific behavior, if the action is here and it's triggered, it means you have enough motivation and you have the ability to do it. So if it's triggered, the behavior will occur. Anything below the action line, any behavior that occurs down here, you might have the motivation and the ability, or you might have the trigger, but you don't have the motivation or ability. Okay, one or the other. So a good way to think about this is, if there's $20 right here in the middle of the table, you have the motivation and you have the trigger, but you may not have the ability to reach over and grab it. You might be too far away, or you might not have the ability in social context to like interrupt a conversation to go take it. But he might have the best chance because he's close, right? So he has the motivation, ability, trigger. Cool. All right, so we were defining. So if there's $20 bills, $20 bill in the middle of the table, you probably have the motivation, you have the ability, and you can see it, so it's triggered. Another example is if I were to tell you there's a $100 bill up on the building over there, you might have the motivation, and I just triggered you, but you don't have the ability, you don't know how to get to that $100, right? So the behavior will not occur. You won't, unless you are really, really highly motivated, you won't go find that $100 bill. So you have the motivation and the trigger, but no ability. Okay, finally, let's say there's a penny on the ground right next to you on the floor, right? You have the ability and you see it, so there's a trigger, but you probably have no motivation to pick it up, right? Unless you're my mom, who's Dutch and loves to pick up any money she sees, right? So a behavior occurs, it needs motivation, ability, and trigger at the same time. And if you'll notice, there's 2 points right here for a reason. Some things are, you might be motivated to do, but you have no ability whatsoever. So I might say, hey, I want to do a 360 dunk between my legs, but I have no physical, I could work as hard as I wanted for the rest of my life and that'll never happen, right? There's also things that are so easy, like a penny on the ground, that I will never take the time to do because I'm not motivated enough, okay? So that's how behavior works. So when we think about behaviors, designing for behavior, we want to clearly define the behavior. We want to understand the motivation, try to eliminate ability barriers, and actively trigger. Okay, so thinking about peak performance, working out is one of those things in peak performance. So let's say I want to work out more. So working out is not a very clearly defined behavior. How could I clearly define the behavior of working out? What are the things that I could put there instead?
How often you go to the gym and what exactly you do there.
Exactly. So I would have to define how often do I go and what do I do there, right? So if I wanted to clearly define this behavior, it might be I'm going to go to the gym 3 days a week and do a set workout from my strength coach. So one of the reasons why most people fail at working out is because there's way too much cognitive burden, which we'll talk about when we get to ability, in what they define as their behavior. Most people say, oh, I'm gonna go work out. So New Year's comes along, they set a resolution of, I'm gonna go work out 3 times a week, but they don't know what they're gonna do. They don't necessarily know how they're gonna do it. They don't maybe even know where they're gonna do it. So when we get to this ability piece, even though their motivation is high, coming January 1st, their ability may not be there after a set period of time. Okay, so when I think about it, designing for behavior, the most important thing to me is focusing on ability. So there's 6 ability barriers. Again, this is all from Dr. Fogg's model, and I think he even got rid of one of them, social dissonance.
Yeah.
So it might be 5.
Correct.
Now, I still like social dissonance because I think social norms and habits play a huge role in what we do. Again, the whole phone thing, it's a social norm that if I'm in a conversation, it's not a good idea to pull out my phone and check it, especially as a speaker. So I think social, I don't know if that's more motivation or ability, but there's physical effort. Cognitive effort. Time. Money, habits, and I'm still going to include social in parentheses. So, to define elite performance from these different perspectives, as a college athlete at Stanford, you obviously have the physical talents, right? I'm 6'9", 230 pounds, relatively athletic, otherwise I wouldn't have been here recruited. So you have the physical ability to be here, right? In terms of cognitive effort, for many of the behaviors that you have, I have a strength coach, I have a skills coach, I have basketball coaches, I have trainers. So all of the cognitive effort is really taken, offloaded from me on what I have to do, how I have to do it, and when I have to do it. Time, right? They create the time. I have all this schedule set up. The biggest part of that, though, is social norms. If I don't show up, my teammates will have to run, I'll have to run. Everybody will be angry at me. So they've created the social norm of you just show up. And then in terms of money, they've paid for my scholarship. In terms of habits, it already fits with what I'm already doing. And so when people think, as a Stanford athlete, how can you do all the things that you're required to do? It's because the environment is set up to remove all ability barriers. Now granted, there might be times where school and sports are against each other, but they've also set all these things up for academics. They get your tutors to take away from, hey, I don't have time to study. Well, let's make your studying time more efficient. What do you need to study, okay? They set up study hall where it's mandatory, so you help build good habits. And again, they pay for your books, so you don't have to worry about buying books and worry about, I don't have money for those books, so I'm not gonna do it. So when you think about the ability barriers and what allows people to be a peak performing athlete and student here at Stanford, it's because they eliminate many of the ability barriers that it takes to do both. Finally, they add triggers. So I like to think of triggers as terms of internal and external, right? How many of you ever feel hungry? Right, that's a pretty good trigger to go eat, right? You have you feel hungry, you go eat. Another trigger is, hey, it's lunchtime, it's noon, right? That might be a more external trigger to go eat. So internal, external, timely, right? Getting a text notification to call somebody at midnight is probably not as timely as getting it at 5 p.m., okay? So timely, timeliness of triggers is very important. Relevant, okay? If I'm getting a trigger in the mail that's telling me to go to a website, so I'm getting a letter in the mail telling me to go to a website, probably less relevant than if I got an email, okay? And then finally, last one is variable. How many of you receive a notification on your phone over and over, maybe it's a daily notification, over and over and over again, you just start ignoring it, right? How many people? Okay, so unless the trigger is variable, we'll just start ignoring it, okay? So timely, relevant, and variable. Because remember, without a trigger that we perceive, a behavior will never occur. Okay, because even if I'm here, I'm motivated, right? I might be motivated to go to that website to do whatever they're asking me to do, and I have the ability to happen. Okay, so now I want to talk about, so now that you have an understanding kind of the behavioral side, I want to talk about the systems of performance psychology. So performance psychology, I work with a few elite performance psychologists that have worked with the Bulls in the 90s, the Seahawks of today, and several elite professional athletes. And the number one thing that they talk about, and I'm going to erase all this stuff. Does everybody have enough of this? We can continue to talk about it in Q&A. So what all of them try to do with their elite athletes who are trying to be peak performers, and they would argue with anybody that's trying to be a peak performer, is the idea of being present. And in today's world, that's harder than ever because everything is trying to get you present to their thing. Social media is trying to get you present into Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. People are trying to get you present to them. Companies are trying to get you present to their content, to their products, etc. So it's harder to be present to what you choose to be present to, whether that's work, whether that's family, whether that's a book you want to read. So one of the things that I always think about with peak performance is that when I think about my parents' generation, just 40 years ago as kids, you know, my age, 20, 30, 40 years ago, they didn't have anything but three channels of television. The best thing, the most entertaining thing they could do is play with friends outside or read a book, right? Imagine that, kids today having the most entertaining thing be reading a book or playing with friends outside. Now they can play video games, they can watch an infinite number of videos, TV shows, content, short form YouTube streams, they can check out Instagram feeds, they have infinite number of things at their fingertip just by going on their smartphone. So in terms of being present, there are a lot more distractions. And so unless we know how to deal with those distractions, i.e. removing triggers for things that we don't want to be a part of, or making it harder to do. So for example, I just got the iPhone 6 Plus. I don't use the thumbprint because that makes it too easy for me to log into my phone. I think it's a 14-digit passcode. Right? So even the 4-digit is so fast, you almost do it unconsciously. But instead, I chose something with letters, numbers, special characters, and it's a reminder of me to be present. So by the time I get halfway through my passcode, I'm like, do I really want to be here? Because I can do a lot of things unconsciously without being present. Another thing, another problem with being present is sometimes the present can be uncomfortable. Why do people go to all those things? Because they're bored. Right? And when you're bored, you just want to leave the present moment. So if I'm in a situation where I'm bored, it's really easy for me to gratify myself in some other way. Right? The present can also be uncomfortable because there are things happening here that I don't like. You might be at a family gathering with your aunt that you just don't like, or that it keeps bringing up the story of you, you know, like my aunt always calls me Andy Roo. My name's Andrew. She always calls me that, still calls me that. And every time I'm like, oh, I just don't want to be here. Right? So you don't want to be there. So there's a lot of things bringing you out of the present moment. The best way to get back into the present moment is to accept what is. Okay? So in performance psychology, or in any type of performance situation, whether it's a boss yelling at you, coach yelling at you, as an athlete, you have to deal with a coach probably saying things to you that never would be acceptable in any other situation, right? So if you're an employer, or you're an employee and your boss comes to you and says some of the not so nice things I've heard in the locker room, chances are you'd have a pretty good opportunity to sue for something. But as an athlete, again, going back to the social norms, that's normal. And I think that's part of the reason why companies like hiring athletes is because they know how to deal with people getting on them and moving forward. Because what's uncomfortable for many people is not quite so uncomfortable for an athlete. We've gotten used to this idea of comfortable being uncomfortable. We push ourselves physically, we push ourselves mentally, and for many, push ourselves emotionally. So we're good at being present sometimes, not so good at others. Another way to be present is to focus on what you can control. A lot of times we get brought out of the present moment because we're focused on things that are out of our control. How many of you think that you can control results and outcomes? So if you want to get a raise, how many people think that you can do what it takes to get a raise?
You mean 100% control or partial control?
100%, well, is it control if you can't 100% control it?
Well, that's why I'm asking, because it's a semantical point at some level.
Yeah, so I'll get to that. So you might be able to control parts, but you can't control results. So I talk to a lot of athletes, and a lot of athletes, when I ask them, can you control winning or losing? They're like, yes, because I can control X, Y, Z. And I was like, if you can control winning and losing, would you ever lose? Mm-hmm. No, you would never lose. For basketball, can you control making and missing shots? Lots of athletes will say yes, because I can get shots up, I can get better, I can take good shots, it's like, but then you would never miss. So what they're talking about, they're actually talking about things that are in their control. Because you can control, so you can't control, in my mind, results and outcomes. So if you think about this, in the regular world, you can't control whether you get a promotion, you can't control the job you get. You control some things, you control your attitude, effort, and focus. So I guarantee you that if you bring a great attitude, you bring maximum effort, and you bring your focus to the present moment, you give yourself a good shot to get those results and outcomes. So when we work with elite athletes, a lot of the times they have felt that they've controlled the results and outcomes their entire life. We have one athlete, he was the male athlete of the year as an 18-year-old. In Sports Illustrated, male athlete of the year, he'd won a World Olympic medal. He was the fourth pick in the NBA draft, making millions and millions of dollars. He had lost in his 16 years of basketball. He could probably count the number of times he had lost on a major scale. In you know, hands and toes, probably count the number of times he lost from high school and college. He got into the NBA, and his first year in the NBA, guess what? He lost that many times in 2 weeks. So in 2 weeks' time, he had lost more games than he had ever lost in his life, and he thought he was falling apart. He was looking at results and outcomes as something that he could control. So when those were going poorly, he said, I am a bad basketball player. And even worse, he said, I am a bad human being. Right? So we had to help him say, even though for most of your life it seemed and appeared that you could control results and outcomes because physically you were gifted and you were very skilled and talented, ultimately there'll come a time, because again, he was playing against other people, some of which had been in the NBA longer than he had been alive. So people, same level of talent, same level of ability, and he had to separate who he was from who he was as an athlete and the fact that he could not control results and outcomes. Now that he's done that, he's in his third year in the NBA and he's doing much better. But mostly he's able to separate who he is from who he is as an athlete and therefore is able to thrive much more than he was before. Because before he was in survival mode, and when he was in survival mode, I guarantee you he was very stressed and he wasn't performing at his highest level. Does this all make sense so far? Okay. Finally, the last piece, so being present, accepting how you feel, focusing on what you can control. We like to call the next piece, next place speed. Being in the present moment is really, really hard. Okay, because there's a lot of things that come up. I'm bored, right? Or I'm really good at something, or I'm really bad at something. All these things bring you out of the present moment. We call this next place speed, and this is where awareness comes back in. When you realize that you've lost your focus on what you can control, or you're no longer in the present moment, we want you to bring your awareness back and your focus back to your attitude, your effort, and your focus in this present moment. If you can do that, you'll be a high-level performer. Okay? So without the awareness piece, you won't bring it back. That's where meditation is a great awareness tool or a great performance tool because it does those three things. I focus on my breath, which is I choose my focus. I bring a great attitude and effort to that. Okay, so you do all the things that are in your control, right? So if I'm focused on my breath, bring a good attitude and effort. And then when I lose my focus, I bring it back. Next place speed. So three principles. What do most people do that are highly competitive when they first try to meditate? When they realize they've lost their focus, they get upset, right? Which, when our brain realizes those things, it doesn't realize that you're upset that you lost your focus. It might think you're upset now that you remembered that you became aware, and so now it's hurting your awareness. So instead, you want to celebrate the fact that you became aware that you were not focused on your breath. Does that make sense? I'm going to say that again. So when I focus on my breath, all of a sudden become aware that I've lost focus on my breath, I celebrate. Because that celebration rewards my awareness. So another way to look at that is, I'm at work, and I'm furiously working, I'm in the zone. All of a sudden I realize the last 10, 15, 20, 30 minutes I've been on Facebook. How did that happen? I have no idea when that happened or how it happened. I'm sure it's happened to every one of us. And in that moment, just like in meditation, when we realize we lost our focus on our breath, most of our response is, ugh, like, what am I doing? I just wasted 30 minutes. Now I have to spend an extra 30 minutes at the end of the day or more at work. Instead of, woo, I'm glad I realized I'm on Facebook because I could have spent hours on here. Like, I'm glad that I'm aware that I spent 30 minutes because that celebration of awareness helps to bring it back. Okay, so you might waste 30 minutes. Next time you might only waste 20. Next time 5. So that's where meditation is one of the tools we use with athletes. Not as a way to control what they think about or to eliminate thoughts, but to help them to be present and to work on a couple of the skills of peak performance. Okay? Because once you become aware, you can activate your ability. So once you become aware that you lost your focus, it gives you the ability to bring it back. Okay? And once you have, again, the repetitions of doing that, you have this experience where, wow, this actually works. It helps me in a game when I lose my focus on a mistake that I made. I can bring it back to this present moment. I don't have to worry about what happened, okay? So I'm gonna kind of cut it here and open it up for questions. I know I kind of talked about a lot of stuff, but I also wanna open it up to people to have questions because that's one of my favorite ways to interact and make it tangible and real for what people are dealing with. So I don't know, Margarita, how you want to queue up the Q&A or if...
So, so let's just open it up to the audience. I have one question for you.
Mm-hmm.
So one is the neuroscience of peak performance. Do you have any comments or insights about brain chemistry or neuroplasticity and how that plays into performance and behavior design?
Yeah, so we talked a little bit about it, I referenced it, I guess, when you talk about moving from surviving to thriving. So we have predisposed wiring to surviving. And the problem is most people don't have a very defined sense of what is a real survival, a survival situation versus when you have that response in a non-survival setting. Because performance has always been tied to surviving. Does that make sense? So in the majority of our history, if you didn't perform well, you didn't survive. That's not necessarily true anymore, right? Even if I perform poorly and everybody in the world hates me, I'll still survive to a decent, probably a decent level. Even if I'm homeless, like in America, if you're homeless, you're probably still able to survive better than a majority of the world, the rest of the existence before today. So what we like to do in the performance psychology, again, with the meditation and mindfulness, it helps you to fine-tune when you have that response to be able to say, this is a real survival situation and go down that path, or this is not real survival and now I need to reframe the feeling. Okay, so before you would feel I'm in survival mode, you have your fight or flight response and the neurochemistry is there, versus what we try to do is use a lot of these tools, again, through repetitions and designing environments for people and for our athletes to then reframe what they're feeling and know that that's really the thriving. So just like when we work on meditation and say, reframe that feeling you get of I'm frustrated to cool, like it's excitement to bring it back, you're rewiring your nervous system to view performance situations as thriving situations, an opportunity for you to advance and grow as opposed to a chance that you'll lose. Right, so then coming up and speaking, you're not saying, oh, after I'm done speaking, I'll either be hated, which then leads to me being homeless and then dying, to I'll go up and speak and there's this opportunity in front of me to do something great. And even if it goes terribly, I can learn from it so that next time I can do better. So that's part of the psychology and the neuroscience of rewiring, using different parts of our brain, using our cognitive function, our conscious function, as opposed to relying on, in these situations, our unconscious kind of survival or thrive mechanism. Yes?
Is there a difference in how you would be present in like a practice situation and then under like a high emotion situation, like you're in the game that matters?
Yeah, so this is one of the things that a lot of athletes talk about. Michael Jordan was quoted as saying, whether I'm on the playground or in the championship game, it's the same shot, right? And most people take it as he practices with the same intensity with which he would play, which is true, but it's also false. He doesn't put any more pressure on himself in that situation. What I talk to a lot of young players about is that when they're in practice and they're shooting free throws, they could probably shoot a pretty high percentage. But when they're in games, they've been conditioned to think that that's more important, right? Even though it's 1 point, right? And I ask them, what's more important, missing a free throw in the first minute of the game or the last minute of a close game? And almost 100% of the time, they'll say the last minute of a game, of a close game, even though they're just as important. So psychologically, the way I approach practice with a lot of athletes is similar to what I do in games, is you focus on what you can control. And it's difficult because being present in practice a lot of times is I need to work on things that I'm not very good at so that in a game I'm more comfortable. So in practice, I push athletes to get really uncomfortable doing what they're doing, right? So going harder, pushing farther than what they would do in a game because there's not as much emotional stress in practice as there is in a game, right? If I make a mistake in practice, so what, next play, move on. But if I make a mistake in a game, there's a lot more perceived value because there's fans, there's coaches, there's other teammates, there's referees, all these people making judgments on my performance, usually based on results and outcomes, not attitude, effort, and focus. And so I call practice, I like to call it the sandbox, creating a sandbox for you to do things that are uncomfortable so that when you do it on the stage, you've had reps. So for example, if I was feeling nervous about presenting, a sandbox might be cool. I'm going to record myself a couple times. I'm going to watch it. I'm going to deal with the emotions that I'm feeling. I'm going to feel them. I'm going to accept them, let them go, and get my reps in so that when I get up in front of people, I've at least had some experiences. That doesn't mean the emotions aren't going to be there, that you aren't going to feel them, but you'll at least know how to deal with them better than if you didn't have that practice rep or that game rep.
So Andrew, one of the things that we've noted in the neuroscience literature is the importance of early success and early wins.
Mm-hmm.
And it turns out that if you have a small win, neurochemically you get a hit of both adrenaline and testosterone.
Mm-hmm.
And what that results in is it gives you confidence to take a risk again.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's what would you say to people who coach or manage
mm-hmm.
other people to get peak performance out of them?
Mm-hmm.
So not so much that we're the
yeah.
object of the peak performance, but we're there to support others. What could we do
yeah.
to elevate their performance?
Yeah, so great point. And I'll illustrate in one way. How many of you have had a situation where you've been asked to do something or expected to do something that you knew there was no way you were going to accomplish successfully? How motivated were you in that moment? Or how stressed? Probably pretty stressed, right? What if instead in that situation, whoever put that task on you said, give it your maximum effort, have a great attitude, and just be focused on it for whatever period of time. And if you do that, whatever happens at the end of this, we'll be able to live with. How would that have made you feel?
Awesome.
Right, so I coached a group of sixth graders. To see, one of our goals was to see how young kids can start to understand some of these principles. And to get to your point of early successes, I only focused on three things: attitude, effort, focus, staying present, and moving on to the next play. Right? So they were worried at first when I came in, makes and missed shots, playing time, good and bad statistics, what their parents thought, what other players thought. Right, all of which, again, if we think about it, are out of their control. So all of those are results and outcomes based. Because the first thing kids get asked when they get in the car with their parents is, did you win? How many points did you score? What were your statistics in some way, shape, or form? Which are all out of a player's control. So the best way to give early successes is to focus on what's in their control. So giving kids a chance for early success means, hey, did you have a great attitude? Yes, that's a success. Did you have great effort? Did you give maximum effort? And maximum effort, a lot of people confuse with, I feel 100% good, and I performed at 100% of my capacity, feeling 100% good. Not, hey, I feel terrible today, and I performed terrible, but it was the best that I could do with how I felt and how I, like, if I broke my leg and I go out to play, like, you could still give a great effort and have a great attitude, but your performance, judged against you without a broken leg, won't be as high. So if, as parents and coaches, we're able to separate our emotions from winning and losing, right? Because a lot of times a coach or a boss judges themselves on results and outcomes. If they can separate that instead of passing the buck down, right? Because the coach might say, we just need to get a stop. Of course we do, coach. Like, how do we do that? We're trying. We're not trying to not get a stop and let the other team score. Right? Like, that's the most absurd thing when a coach says, we need to get a stop on defense, right? We can't let the other team score. Everyone knows that, right? So if you just pass it on instead of saying, hey, let's have maximum effort, have a great attitude and focus in this possession, and whatever happens, we'll let it go. That to me is how you get early successes. And so to bring the sixth grade team back, our first tournament we lost all three games by 20 points. And that continued for a couple games, but each practice we started to get better and better, and parents started noticing a difference. And by the end of our season, we were winning tournaments. Other teams were coming up to us, other parents, other coaches, who were saying, what is it about you guys that's so different is like, I don't yell at the refs because the refs are out of our control. I don't let my players worry about the refs because the refs are out of our control. When one of our players makes a mistake, I just yell at them and move on to the next play. So they started to adopt these principles, and so they were always moving. They were always focused on what they were control. They had great attitude, great effort, and great focus. And lo and behold, results started happening. They were willing to take risks because they knew I didn't care if they turned it over. Unless I would care, so I'd pull them out, and I would ask them, like, you know why I pulled you out? I'm like, yeah, I turned the ball over. I was like, no, not because you turned it over. It's because you hung your head after you turned it over. Or it's because you weren't focused. You made a lazy pass. Right? So your effort and your focus weren't there. So once they're back, I'll put you back in the game. So it's highlighting why. So the result and outcome was a turnover. But why did that turnover occur? Maybe they lacked focus, they lacked effort, or they had a bad attitude. So if you can draw those things as a parent or as a coach or as a boss or a manager, you can say, hey, you didn't reach this outcome. It's not because you're not talented or skilled enough, right? Otherwise you wouldn't be here. You're talented and skilled enough. You might have been lacking in one of these areas.
So what is the proper mix of reward versus punishment in sports?
I would argue that what's the point of punishment? So I consult several kind of coaches, and a big thing in sports is that mental toughness is built through running or physical exertion. And unfortunately, that gives athletes a bad mindset towards physical conditioning, which ultimately is a great thing if you want to be successful as an athlete. Right? If I want to be successful as an athlete, I need to be able to run and be in good shape. But because that's used as a punishment for an entire lifespan of an athlete, now they have a negative connotation towards running and won't do it on their own. Right? If we're asked to do conditioning on our own, like it's like the least likely to happen. And you know, on the flip side, rewards, I'm also not a fan. Again, the book Punished by Rewards by Alfie Cohn shows that rewards tend to decrease our intrinsic motivation. And so there's a lot of research on collegiate athletes having a huge decline in intrinsic motivation for their sport because of the rewards and punishments inherent in college athletics and the way they're treated and the environment that they're in. They lose a lot of their natural drive to perform. They only show up when they're asked to show up. They only do what they're asked to do. And very few of them keep that intrinsic drive. And a lot of times you'll see that those end up doing really, really well, those athletes. And I would say it's not because of how they're coached. It's more that they just had that resiliency in them already.
So what could a manager or a coach do, or an individual do, to maintain their intrinsic drive?
Mm-hmm.
You know, what are the things? So we know that rewards and punishments mm-hmm. can negatively yeah. affect it, but what can we do in terms of mm-hmm. self-care yeah. to maintain those intrinsic motivations?
Yeah, I think, again, focus on what's in whoever you're talking to's control, so attitude, effort, focus, or again, just some of the things. How you respond to a situation is in your control. How you frame a situation is in your control. So if my boss comes to me and yells at me, I can reframe it as, hey, he's trying to help me. He's just emotional, and that's how he responded. So I can respond in a more mindful way and take that. One of my friends who played football here said that if he would have been able to separate his performance from who he was as an individual, he would have been much more successful. So helping to separate who someone is as a human being from who someone is as what they choose to perform in, so whether it's work or sports. So for example, when he would watch film with the coaches, he felt that they were attacking him as a human being as opposed to analyzing what he did out on the football field. And so he wasn't able to hear what they were saying because as soon as he felt they were attacking him, he got emotional.
So what language could coaches or managers use so that it doesn't mm-hmm. feel like a personal attack, but rather an observation about a behavior or a
yeah.
technique?
So part of it is just acknowledging that right off the bat, is saying, here is a performance piece, a behavior that we want to modify. It's not, it's you know, one of the things I like to think about is people do the best with what they know, right? And if you come from that understanding, it's analyzing, okay, clearly, like, something we have taught you isn't working out to get what we want. So let's figure that out. It's not about you being a bad person. It's about this performance piece or behavior piece. And I think working with them with that open mindset helps to do that. So let's go back here.
So I want to acknowledge you, Andrew, and not acknowledge that I was I was late, and thus there was something to discover there. However, I was just moved by what I got when I moved when I got in here on the distinction, like being present, mm-hmm. and to follow up on what Margarita just asked. I teach high school kids,
mm-hmm.
and one of the things that I'm looking at is how do I elevate their performance by having them separate the self from the performance itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the activities that I do is I give them like 5 minutes to write down everything that they've ever failed in their life,
mm-hmm.
from the time they were born. And so they write all those things, and then we begin to talk about those specific things and distinguishing that what really happened was that, let's say that a kid says that I failed to dunk.
Mm-hmm.
So what really happened is that you didn't really fail.
Mm-hmm.
So you can't fail as a human being. Like, Mr. Free fails when he dies. And so what really happened was that there was a failure in dunking.
Mm-hmm. It was failure in activity, so not as a human. Yeah.
Yeah, and so having them distinguish that
mm-hmm.
I don't fail. In fact, you've never failed as a human being. Rather, you've failed in a particular activity and performance.
Yeah, we dislike even using the word failure because the way you just define it, right? We can never fail because it's a continuous process from birth to death, right? There's no point in time, and that's why we like the idea of next play speed. If I messed something up yesterday or 10 years ago and I still think about it today, I haven't moved on, right, to the next play. And so I have until I die or pass away to still move on. So if I ended a relationship poorly, I still have a chance to go back and make that right. So there's always an opportunity to move forward and to move on. So we like to say failure is really just a challenge or obstacle or setback. Right, or an opportunity to grow. So you're going to keep, another thing I like to say to a lot of people is life's going to keep giving you a similar lesson until you learn it, right? And so for me, a lot of times it was fearing failure, not getting uncomfortable. So I was always put in situations where I was afraid to fail or I was uncomfortable, but I wanted to get to the other side of that, right? And a lot of times what you'll find is that it requires something that you're passionate about. So getting back to the behavior model, where you're motivated enough, right? So for me, it was basketball, where you're motivated enough where even if something is really challenging, you're willing to go do it. So I had one of those moments with basketball where I had my senior year two hip problems that were going to require surgery and was barely, I was on painkillers, barely walking, one of these terrible sports stories, but I really wanted to be successful and it was my senior year. And my coach said to me, well, if you can't practice, you can't play. And so I had this moment where I was like, screw it. I'm going. I'm doing it. I went all out. So it was an all or nothing moment. And not everybody requires that. But it provided enough motivation to go do the uncomfortable things that I was holding back on. So I was saying, if I'm going to push my body physically, I'm going to push myself mentally. And I finally had that moment where I stopped focusing on results and outcomes, playing time, points that I was scoring, and focused on what do I control. Because now it's no longer, I want to make it to the end of the season, it's, I might only have one game left. And so I'm going to do everything I can in this one game because I'm not guaranteed to be able to play tomorrow. So by focusing on what you can control, it helps to separate your performance and what you do from who you are. And so when we've worked with high schools, for example, and the stress of performance, this area is one of the highest stress areas around test scores and getting into great colleges. And again, those are all results and outcomes. And with social media and technology, kids are more tuned in and checked in to what everybody's doing, what everybody expects of them, that even if there is no more real pressure put on them by parents or the outside world, the perception of pressure is higher. And I like to say perception is reality. So unless we help kids deal with that new perceived pressure, again, in a way, or as parents, you know, my parents didn't necessarily have to talk to me as much about, you know, attitude, effort, and focus, because I couldn't compare my results and outcomes to a kid in California, a kid in New York, or a kid in Wyoming. Like, all I knew was my little community of people, you know, and again, I grew up in a town of 3,000 people, so it was kind of nice. I can only compare myself to so many people. I couldn't see this kid, you know, like, I had a friend at Stanford that she graduated college at 18. Even me being a high achiever in my town might have felt really crappy if I would have known that there's a girl out in Oregon that was graduating college at 18, you know, with three master's degree, or three triple major, and then when she came to Stanford as an 18-year-old was getting a master's degree. So the fact that kids can now compare so highly, it makes it even harder to focus on what they can control.
To what extent do you think the results and outcomes should factor into motivation, if at all? Because for many people, like, it is, like, if you're investing all the time and energy in getting better at something, that sure, that's great in itself, but at some point you might want that to actually be validated by you winning.
Right? Oh, absolutely. And so the way I look at results and outcomes is guideposts of whether I'm doing the right actions, right? So I can say, hey, I want to play Division I college basketball. But if I focus on that every day, that's such an abstract thing that I need to then define behaviors that will get me there. And once I define those behaviors, one of the things I didn't talk about with behavior design is iteration. So if I keep doing a behavior, it's the definition of insane, doing the same thing over and over again, expecting different results. If I design a behavior that's not getting me the result I want, then I iterate and I improve my process. So results and outcomes are still important, but I guarantee you that you won't get those results and outcomes if you just focus on those. So we know that that's where we're trying to go. And then the process is designing the behaviors, because the design of the behavior, that's in my control. And I know that, was I successful with the behavior or not? Yes, no. And then down the road is, if I did that behavior over and over again, and that's what I perceived or thought would get me the result, and all of a sudden I've reached a point where I'm like, this behavior is not getting me that result. Now how do I change the behaviors? Okay, so it's focusing on the things that I can control, is the behaviors that I take. And then the metric of whether those behaviors are successful is what I want, is do I get the results and outcomes?
Sure. Just to play devil's advocate, but they're also not in your control, the results and outcomes that you're using as milestones, right?
Absolutely.
So, like, it's tricky, right? Because in some sense, you keep trying, expecting at some point some of those results may bear out, but it's possible they never may, right? Because they're not in your control.
And so one of your behaviors that you might need to change is your expectations. Okay. So expectations are a behavior. Your mental perceptions are a behavior. So what I choose to believe about myself is something that I can control. So if I perceive myself as a Nobel laureate, right? I would have to A, write every day, be a better writer, do more writing and take classes around writing and do behaviors about becoming a better writer. But then if I never get anything published, I might have to change what I believe or what the expected outcome I want. And so by no means, there are definitely things that, you know, again, one of the athletes, or who's the male athlete, you can jump 50 inches in the air, he's 6'8", just incredibly physically built. He probably has a better chance of getting to the NBA than the 6-foot kid at Palo Alto that can't jump over a box, you know, can't jump over a piece of paper, right? So part of it is knowing how to set your expectations and aligning perception with reality. Because if I perceive that I'm doing better than the reality states, then I'm going to be setting myself up for, you know, for stress and anxiety and things like that.
David, you had a question.
Cool. Yeah, across the peak performers and athletes and the elite performers that you work with, what times during the day do they usually train their minds?
So it definitely depends. So in season, most of them will train right before they do something. Because they want to get themselves into a state. So it'll be before a workout or before a game. And when they do it before games, because we like to get them into, for lack of a better word, necessarily a zen state. So before games, we'll usually do something with them a couple hours before. A lot of professional athletes take naps, and then they'll wake up 3 hours before. So we get them into a certain state right before they take a nap. So that when they wake up, they're feeling regenerated and in the right state of mind to then go out and perform. The other time is right before they're about to practice, because those are the times when they're most likely to fall into a negative mind state. And so we want to prepare them, just like warming up physically before they work out, we want to warm them up mentally to be able to manage. So for me personally, when I do it, it's always before starting work. So now that I'm a professional peak performer, I'll spend the first hour of my day getting my mind and body ready to do whatever it takes the rest of the day.
At home or at work?
It could be a combination of both, depending on, I like to do it where there's quiet, so if I do it at work, it's only on days where I get there before everybody else.
Okay.
Otherwise, it'll be at home. And I always say that if you don't, there's a 10% rule, right, of finance, right? Take 10% and pay yourself first. I like to do the same thing with my time, right? Giving that 10% time and 10% 10% like professional development to myself. And I always use my first couple hours because that's when I'm most alert and aware. And why would you give your best hours to somebody else? So that's how I think about it as a peak performer, is I give my best hours and my best time to me. And then because I do that, I'm able to perform better in all the other areas.
Yeah, I'd like to hear your thoughts on discipline.
Mm-hmm. Discipline in what sense?
Just
like discipline as in punishment, or discipline as in like rigor of daily?
I think it has to deal a little bit with the intrinsic motivation. It has a lot to deal with awareness and repetition. I just find that people who whose performance I admire, whether it's athletic or it's academic, one of their traits is this discipline. Not necessarily being distracted by the short-term distractions or something like that.
Yeah, I think there's a couple pieces. There definitely is the intrinsic motivation. You've seen results and outcomes enough, positive feedback enough, that you're willing to put off the short-term gains. I would tend to argue that a lot of that discipline happens because of their environment. They've created and cultivated an environment where they've removed distractions. For example, I just moved up to San Francisco, and whenever you move or you change your environment, like behaviors will just explode and you'll have to recreate. So one of the things I did when I was stressed out because I was moving, starting, you know, Play Present got acquired, to create an app to get out our mental training. So new job, new people, all these new behaviors. So in my stressful moment, I got Netflix. Never had it for the last couple of years, didn't watch TV. Have Amazon Prime, but there's not really any shows on there that I watch and anything like that. So I would spend more time reading and thinking and writing. And so in my stressed out moment of a new environment, I got Netflix. So what have I been doing the last month and a half?
No.
I've been watching a lot of Netflix. So in a moment of high motivation today, because I was so upset at myself like yesterday, I wasn't feeling well the last 2 days and finally got better. But there's been several Saturdays where I'm now in the city in San Francisco and it's been beautiful out, and I spent 5 to 6 hours of prime daytime watching Netflix, right? So even though I consider myself a very disciplined person, the way I perform, the way I do things, there are times where your environment changes things. So what I do today, when I was sitting outside and I was like, it's so beautiful outside, cancel my Netflix. So,
yes.
So to be a peak performer, sometimes it's making those decisions that set up like a permanent from now on situation. It's also who you decide to be around, right? There's the saying, you are the equivalent of the five people you associate with. So if you associate with high performers or peak performers, you start to build their habits. When I was at Stanford, part of it was I was surrounded by people that were doing great things academically, great things athletically. They were starting companies. So surrounding yourself both environmentally and socially helps you become more disciplined.
Cool.
Rita.
I was wondering, how do you apply the behavior model to, for example, changing someone's attitude?
Mm-hmm.
Can you give some examples of how you might do that? So, for example, somebody who starts out with an attitude that their performance is linked to their identity or some other problematic attitudes,
mm-hmm.
How do you use BMAT to address that?
Yeah, so a lot of it is removing their barriers. So if their bad attitude is related to a culture, right, that's been created in this social norm. Part of it is changing that social norm. So for example, with the sixth graders, they were so focused on results and outcomes that when they didn't get a result and outcome, that was why they had a bad attitude. I don't know if I want to say most people don't inherently have a bad attitude. There's a reason, more or less, a lot of times, why they have a bad attitude. And so part of a bad attitude might be understanding the behaviors that are causing the bad attitude. So maybe they're being triggered by something in their world that's leading to them acting a certain way. So outcome becomes this, which might be because their parents, right, did something, or they're physically not comfortable, right, if they're at practice and my physical body is hurting, then I may have a bad attitude about everything else. And so part of it is really using the behavior model to understand why that behavior is occurring. So the bad attitude behavior is occurring. And then either eliminating the, or adding ability barriers to do the bad behavior, removing a trigger, or motivating through feedback loops of the good behavior. So acknowledging the positive behavior. So with the sixth graders, I had one kid that was probably the worst attitude. For the majority of the group, they bought in real quick. They were able to turn things around. So that created a social environment where it was harder for the one kid to have a bad attitude. But then it still required lots of repetitions of seeing the results of having a good attitude and how that helped him become a better basketball player. Because he was very motivated to be a good basketball player. And it wasn't until he saw that having a good attitude and a great effort aligned with being a good basketball player and having his best performances that he finally made the full transition where it didn't require other players cajoling him or me pushing him in and reinforcing that he finally had the intrinsic motivation to change. So I think the behavior model is great because it's not just a tool for building behaviors, it's a tool for understanding the behavior in the first place. And you can kind of do a little of both. First, understanding why a behavior exists, and then how you might want to modify it.
Okay, one last question.
So instead of, you talked about just acknowledging the positive. And in the beginning, there was also something that you said about just being present and rejoicing when you become aware of whatever the negative was.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just wondering if you want to acknowledge the negative, like acknowledge that I had a bad attitude and that did not give me my desired outcome,
mm-hmm.
and now acknowledge my new attitude.
Yeah, I think acknowledging the bad attitude puts us in a position where now we can choose an action. We can choose to respond. Because if we're not aware that that's occurring or that's hurting our performance, we can't really do anything about it. And that's definitely a hard part because I think a lot of coaches are like, hey, we're making you aware of this bad behavior, but if you don't do it in a way that acknowledges how a person could improve, again, that's separating the person from the behavior, the performance, and helping them focus on, okay, what can I do to change that? Because I were to poll everybody, no one would say, I want to be a bad worker, I want to be a bad employee, I want to be a bad manager, I want to be a bad boss, I want to be a bad coach. But most people just don't know. They know what they know, and so they're doing the best with what they know, and they don't know how to change. So once you help people become aware of that change, a lot of it is empathy and compassion for what they're doing. I think there's a reason why the Warriors are one of the best teams in history, and could possibly be the best team in history, is because one of their, a couple of their things are compassion, joy, right? So when they play, one of their core values is compassion for themselves and for others. When they make a mistake, they're compassionate to move on. They're compassionate to their teammates. They don't get on each other for making mistakes. So I think compassion and empathy can go a long way towards building peak performance in yourself and in others.
So I'm going to ask the Tim Ferriss questions.
Cool.
What books are you reading these days?
Mm-hmm. Okay, so I just finished Originals by Adam Grant. He also wrote Give and Take, which I thought was really good because I feel like I'm a nice guy and I hated the saying nice guys finish last. So he put some good research out there, and Originals was also good. I'm reading Better, Faster, Smarter by Charles Duhigg. And then a great book, I think it might have been Noelle that recommended it, is Aziz Ansari's Modern Romance. If you do it, listen to it on audiobook, and I think it's good for any age bracket. It's just about a data-driven way to understand relationships and love and how technology has shaped and changed those things. Those are the three books I'm on right now.
What is your daily ritual in terms of self-care?
Yeah, so it's tough because I wouldn't necessarily say it's a daily ritual. So BJ with Tiny Habits, highly recommended for everybody. One of his tiny habits is after he goes to the bathroom at home, he'll wash his hands and do his two push-ups. I have a pull-up bar right next in the door to the bathroom, so I'll do some pull-ups, and then usually I tend to do push-ups and whatnot. Try to go to the gym daily. One of the things I've incorporated more is yoga. Yoga was always woo-woo, but now that my body feels like it's 40 after 20 years of basketball, having two hip surgeries, herniated disc in my back, I started doing yoga and I feel amazing. So I try to do yoga 3 times a week. Meditation, but it's not necessarily a breathing meditation. It's a lot of times moving meditation, or I like to use music and dancing, so it's a little different, but those are kind of the self-care things. And then reading and like getting thoughts down, or every morning, just like clockwork.
And who are the people you most admire?
Yeah, well, BJ's one. I've been fortunate to have a lot of good mentors, so BJ Fogg is someone that I tell everybody about. My business partner, Graham, is someone that I admire. He works with a ton of elite athletes, but also maintains a great family life. He's got amazing kids, amazing relationship with his wife, and he applies many of these performance principles to his relationships, which allows him to be one of those people that you love being around. Yeah, I would say those are the two that I most look up to.
And then lastly, what would be the one thing that you would want us to start doing on Monday morning? If we did nothing else, this one thing that would make an improvement in our lives?
So we have a principle called breathe and be. And it relates to breathe and be cool and breathe and act aggressive. So one thing I'd want you to take away is every moment breathe and be, and then notice if, because water doesn't move when it's frozen, right? So when you're cold, you might need to act aggressive. So you might have this fearful moment where I don't want to do something. So breathing and being allows you to recognize that and take action, knowing that you're going to be okay. Then there's breathe and be cool. When water gets really hot, it turns into heat and vapor and it evaporates away, so you can't direct that energy. Instead, use that moment to breathe and be cool and direct that energy towards what you want to get done. So it starts with breathing and being. So breathe and be, and you can do that any moment, right? You can take a deep breath right now and be, and notice what you feel, right? So it all starts from there.
Great. Thank you so much, Andrew.
Yeah, thank you.